Good morning and welcome to our morning musings as we begin a new week. Let's begin with Luther's morning prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have protected me through the night from all harm and danger. And I ask that you would also protect me today from sin and all evil, so that my life and actions may please you. Into your hands I commend myself, my body, my soul, and all that is mine. Let your holy angels be with me, so that your wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. Well, in our morning musings, we are looking at the readings that we will hear this coming Sunday, and we have a psalm, Psalm 138. It is a psalm of great thanksgiving and praise. And you know, during these days when sometimes we struggle with pandemics or maybe things that are just the ordinary ills and pains of life, how good it is to have a psalm that lifts our eyes beyond this moment around us to the glorious, steadfast love of God, to the glorious truth that God is here and God is still our God, and that his love for us still surrounds us. So listen to this psalm. It's attributed to David. Now, a little bit about psalms attributed to David. That doesn't mean that David wrote all the psalms. I'm not doubting that he wrote some of the psalms. But when he was king, many people wrote psalms for the court, and they were given the king credit for the writing of the psalms. So he was kind of the patron of some of the psalmists. But whether this comes from the mouth of David or one of the others, it certainly could come from our mouth this morning as we seek to praise God. So Psalm 138, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart, for the gods, before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks for your name, for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted your name and your word is above everything. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased my strength of soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth, and they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he perceives far from far away. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve me against the wrath of my enemies. You stretch out my hand, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. So let me talk a little bit about right there at the very beginning. There's a little stumbling block we need to kind of clear up. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. Gods? I thought there was only one true God. Well, one of the images in Scripture is that there is this heavenly court, angels or other divine beings, not necessarily gods, but divine beings, that kind of surround God, much like the earthly King David was surrounded by a court of his advisors and those who attended to him. So there is that picture in the mind of the psalmist of God above. It's used elsewhere in Scripture. Remember Isaiah when he gets his heavenly vision and there's God and then around him are the seraphim and the cherubim and the singing angels and the 20, you know, it's this massive court is the image now. But all of them make very, very clear that there's only one God. Not that these others have power or can help us, but that this is the image. My sense is that it's probably the psalmist using the royal, glorious court that the psalmist is familiar with, and then kind of applying it to the heavenly kingdom. So be not afraid. Although I will mention, Luther does address the fact that there may be other gods, small g. In the understanding of the first commandment. Remember the first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me? Well, in that case, Luther says, we're not talking about other heavenly beings, we're talking about the things that we make into gods. We humans make God out of popularity. We make a God out of money. We make a God out of security. God, for Luther, in that understanding of the first commandment, is anything that we trust in more than God. God needs to be our ultimate foundation. And David, the psalmist, tells us why that's true. Why should God be that in which we trust above all things? Because God is the one who has given us a promise, a word, as it says in the psalm. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth, the promises of your mouth. And those promises God keeps. God keeps his promises. Money can promise that it'll take away all of our pain, but look at the wealthy and you kind of wonder, well, that's not true. And some people think, well, as long as you have health, you have everything. And we see people who are tremendously physically fit, and good for them that they are caring for the body that God gave them. But, you know, the body will fail. Health will pass. We have people who think they're going to trust in popularity. And think of all the stars and ball players who have fallen from grace. Popularity is not everything. In fact, it's probably the emptiest of all the false gods we make. So these are gods that we create. These are gods that we shape and form and then put our trust in. And those are all going to fail us. But in the psalm says, you know, God, though, that's different. That's what makes God the one true God. The one true God who makes promises. And what are those promises? Well, that you are loved by this God. There is nothing that you're going to do to make God love you more. There's nothing that you're going to do that's going to make God love you less. Because God's love for you is a promise from the very lips of God. What other promises? The promise of forgiveness. That we daily can rise and be given a new life. That every day, whatever yesterday were our failings, we are forgiven. And in that forgiveness, we can rise to try again to live out our lives as disciples of the Most High. And out of that forgiveness, we are given life, and life everlasting. We are given life every day, new life, to live in new ways to the glory and thanks of God. And at the end of our time, when this body fails us, God will raise us up to a new life. Only God, the one true God, can keep that promise to us. God's promise to be with us, that love is not a love from afar, but a love that is near. The psalmist says that God in his heavenly court doesn't set some far away in the universe, but draws near to the lowly. And so God is there. Remember yesterday we read the story of the Canaanite woman. Even though she wrestles with God, Jesus is there. She stays near God. And Jesus stays near her and in the end grants her her blessing. So this word of God is the promise of today. That's where I want us to leave our conversation and our reflection, with that truth, that this is the foundation, this is the rock upon which we can build our lives, and this is the rock upon which we can stand as we face today, whatever this day brings, that this promise that God has given us, to love us, to give us life and life everlasting, and to be with us, these words proceed from the one true God. And if we've learned anything from Scripture, when God makes a promise, God keeps a promise. Whether it's a promise to Israel of the Old Testament or the promises that came from the lips of our Lord Jesus Christ as he walked the roads of Palestine, God keeps his promises. And it is that steadfast word of God, that certain promise of God that gives us the joy of each day, gives us the courage of each day, gives us the absolute certainty that nothing will take us out of the hands of God this day. And so I pray to the Heavenly Father that you today you know the wonder and the glory of the promises of God. So in our prayers for this morning, we're going to pray for Francis Wire. She is hospitalized. She should be coming home maybe sometime this week, but we want to keep her in our prayers. Ann Walker continues to do well in her rehab. Talked to Bill yesterday, hopefully she'll continue. We did learn that Pastor Dwayne Salmas has now entered hospice care, and so please keep him for a peaceful transition and his family in your prayers as well. Paul Frierson is having surgery tomorrow. They've discovered a node in his lung, and the location is such that he's going to have surgery to remove a portion of his lung. So that's going to be a difficult surgery, a difficult recovery, so please do keep Paul in your prayers. Rick Sponholz, many of you know, is a former member of Christ the King, and he has asked our prayers as he is battling cancer. Elaine Malzahn is suffering with some back pain, and so we pray that God eases that suffering and pain. It's, you know, when it's suffering in your back, you can't sit, you can't stand, you can't lay down, it's just you can't get relief, and so we pray for Elaine today. And Judy Matson gives us a couple of people that she would like us to remember in prayer. Catherine, her sister-in-law, who is battling ovarian cancer, and a brother-in-law, John, who is hospitalized. So a lot of things right now in Judy's family that we want to be praying for. So let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory be to you, O God. Praise be to you, O God, for the glorious promise of your lips, the promise that says we are loved, the promise that says that this day we are given life and eventually life everlasting, the promise that this day you will walk with us, and that whatever challenges we face, you are there to hold us and keep us until that day of everlasting life. It is in that sure and certain promise, and that you keep that promise, that you are the one true God in whom we can place our trust with confidence. We believe and trust in you, O God, to give us this day all that we need, that you will be with us throughout this day. We pray, Heavenly Father, that while your presence is with us always, that your presence be especially with those on our prayer list, those who are suffering, that they might know your healing and your strength. We pray for Francis and Anne, for Paul and Rick, for Elaine, Catherine, John, and so many others, Heavenly Father. And today we pray especially for Pastor Dwayne Salmas. We pray that as he transitions into the life everlasting, into the kingdom of God, that his passing is peaceful. May the promise that you've made to him of life everlasting ease the grief of those who love him as they commend him into your eternal care. All this we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.